Now, speaking of ridiculous conjectural ideas, a deliberation that I was toying with is, how do you maintain a notion of having a fixed future given a past while leaving room for choice? Can you do so? Can you make those reconciled or harmonized? So one way is that rather than selecting from different possible futures, which is what we traditionally think of as what free will may be, or choice in general, what if you have a selection of different pasts? So that is to say that we think that with our choices, we create a future event, but it's more like, rather, what we do with our choices is we're selecting from different pasts, and the future then changes accordingly. It's not becoming, it's be pasting. But anyhow, I want to hear more about your idea of becoming.
Yeah. Good question. What I'm proposing is that if there is a becoming, this becoming is the master asymmetry of time. So the second law of thermodynamics, the cosmological era of time, gravitational, all of them in some way that I still can't figure out, they can be derived from it. So becoming is the cause, is the master asymmetry, which lies at the foundation, which is underlies all the other asymmetries. Mm-hmm. And I want to show you how sometimes you can pick a special past, at least at the quantum mechanical realm. I wish I could, we could pick up another past. But I want to show that at the quantum mechanical realm, you can pick in a very non-trivial way between different pasts and get very interesting results from them.
Okay, let's hear it.
So here it is. Let's take the becoming, just the naive view that indeed time is moving, as the very foundation of physics. Forget about relativity, whether how you reconcile it. With quantum mechanics, it will be easier, but let's follow its consequences. And I want to begin with quantum mechanics. And, quantum mechanics has, it differs from classical mechanics in many, many aspects. It is non-local. It has superposition. It has uncertainty. I would like to propose that one of the main characteristics of quantum mechanics is its extreme time symmetry, such that events can occur and then unoccur. That in quantum mechanics, sometimes you abolish events that already happened in a way that actually they don't exist, that you are changing your past. This is a work by Liao Cohen and myself. And we argued in a paper that this is a key for understanding many oddities of quantum mechanics. For example, the bomb testing experiment of Weidman and myself. So, let me show you. Perhaps I'll come back to this later. But here it is.
Okay.
Can you see? I'm showing you two particles which are split by a beam splitter. So on the right you see an electron. On the left you see a positron. One yellow, one red. And now this is I'm following an idea, a very famous experiment proposed by my friend Lucian Hardy many years ago, but with a slight modification. I arrange them such that the left part of the electron's wave function is going to cross the two parts of the positron's wave function. Don't worry about the experimental details, timing, and so on, but it goes like that.
Uh-huh.
That actually they have a chance to meet and then give rise to annihilation at two points. Can you see that their interaction is asymmetric? Okay. The electron may meet the positron either at the first intersection or at the second intersection. Suppose that I can make it, and today it is actually even possible to arrange an experiment in which they can meet. Now, the question is, because they are in a superposition, you are not sure that they'll meet, right? The electron may go actually to the right and never meet the positron.
Right. And also, if it were to hit this, it would hit the right one. Or the left one, not both, and it would hit the right one first.
Absolutely.
And the left one later.
Absolutely.
And it will only hit the left one if it did not hit the right one.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Okay. Lastly, on the right-hand side, is there a reason that it's going at a slower speed? Or it doesn't actually matter?
No, just out of convenience. Do it. Just in order to give it a chance, but you can arrange it in another way. So just for for graphical convenience.
Got it.
So you post select it now. In some cases, you will have an annihilation in the first encounter, and then you discard this experiment. In other cases, you're going to have an annihilation in the other intersection. Okay, you place there's two detectors for gamma photons, and you see whether you register them. So you discard these. What about the cases in which both of them do not occur? Now you have an interesting situation. You have made a measurement. So far, they were measuring the position of one another, kind of doing a measurement, whether they're on the right and on the left. But once the two detectors remain silent, you understand that the electron is not in a superposition anymore. It went only to the right. Okay? That means that if you perform an interference experiment with the electron, you will see it sometimes emerging to the left rather than to the right because the wave function has now changed. Okay? Do you understand it? There is the uncertainty principle says that if you have measured the position, then you have lost the momentum. So in this case, now there is no more superposition. And if you try to combine it, the two parts of the B to this Mach-Zehnder interferometer will be lost. So the momentum of the electron has changed. Do we agree with that?
Yes. Okay. No, wait. Just a moment, please. So all I know is that if you don't see any ticks in the photon counter, that you can deduce that the positron went to the right.
No. Here is the surprise. The yellow is the electron, I think. Yeah. So you deduce...
Oh, sorry. Okay. My bad.
I deduce that the electron went to the right. Now, suppose that after that, you know, I can make an interference experiment. You agree that with the positron, I can make an interference experiment, place two mirrors, and then bring them back, and then I'll get interference. The momentum will be preserved. Okay?
Okay.
A Mach-Zehnder interferometer is a device by which a particle goes through a beam splitter, just like this one. So it goes either to the right or to the left. Then you place two mirrors on the two sides, and then you recombine the two parts of the wave function. So you actually don't know whether it went to the right or to the left. This is the Litzer-Weidmann bomb testing experiment. We are basing our work on the Mach-Zehnder interferometer. So this is a Mach-Zehnder. So suppose that I now try to reunite the two halves of the yellow electron in order to get interference. I will not get interference. It will emerge sometimes to the right or sometimes to the left because actually its momentum has changed. Think about the positron, on the other hand. If you reunite back its two parts, it will always go to the right due to interference because it is in a superposition. There is another way that I can show it to you. As you can see, both the right and the left are encountering two mirrors, the electron and the positron. Okay, you can see a mirror. The two solid lines, the black lines, look at the positron on the left. Okay, so the two black lines are mirrors. So if you bring the two halves of the wave function back, they will always go back to the source. Okay, because you are time reversing the whole thing.
Yes.
Suppose that you do the same thing with the electron. And you place a mirror here and a mirror in the other place where it could have gone has there been no positron. Mm-hmm. It will also go back to its... But in this case, you can do the experiment, and in half of the cases, it will not go to the source. It will go to the wall. You have changed the momentum of the electron.
Hmm.
This is called, this is not a Mach-Zehnder interferometer, it is a Michelson interferometer. It's a simple one. You split the particle into two and then reflect back the two halves of the ray to the first beam splitter. So, of course, they'll go back to the source. But as you can see, the electrons' momentum has changed. In half of the cases, it will not go back if you reflect it by the mirror. It will not go back to its source. but it will go to the other side, okay? Because one half of the wave function has been has disappeared.
Right. Now that's provided that you detected no photons, or that's only because of the presence of the
No. Suppose that there was no positron and just the electron has been, just as I showed earlier, the electron has been split into two. So suppose I place four mirrors on the two sides.
Mm-hmm.
So you understand that if there was no positron there, the electron would just go back to its source undisturbed.
Correct.
Now that the two annihilations did not occur, you see that the electron is disturbed.
Right.
But now there is something strange. The positron remains oblivious of the whole thing. There has been an interaction here between them. So you had two bodies interacting with one another. As a result of the interaction, one of them, its momentum is changed, and the other remains completely oblivious of this interaction.
Mm-hmm.
Why do I feel that there is a law from 1666 that somehow, you know, that this interaction is not compatible with it?
Right.
Here's Newton's third law of action and reaction. And you see an interaction between two particles. One of them is affected. The other is completely unaffected.
Now, what if someone says, okay, the positron is not affected, but the composite system of the positron tensored with the photon detectors are?
Still, there is something interesting. You don't have anything like that in classical physics. In classical physics, when you run a process backwards, then either everything is run nicely backwards, or all parties are affected. In this case, actually, you can show that for a while there was an entanglement between the electron and the proton. If one is on the right, the other is on the left. If that one is on the left, the other is on the right. And then actually the path is undone. The entanglement between them is dissolved and the positron goes back to its state. We called it quantum oblivion.
Uh-huh.
And we showed that many oddities of quantum mechanics, interaction-free measurement, the Aharonov-Bohm effect, the Zeno effect, quantum erasure, and so on, all are based on this capability of quantum events to become and then unbecome. In other words, there has been a time in which there was a virtual gamma photon going to the first detector. It's been there for a while, but then it was undone. The possibility was wiped out. The same with the other detector. So you are correct in saying that there are photons here which we do not see them, kind of virtual photon that could have existed, but they did not exist. All this shows you that in quantum mechanics, there are events that you no more see them. And you don't see them anymore, but they have been there and the past is in some way being obliterated.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.